Hello, I'm Robert Breaker, Missionary Evangelist to the Spanish and English speaking people, and we're beginning our Why I'm Not series today with the topic of why I'm not a Calvinist. I'm going to begin this series on why I'm not, and I'm going to look at different denominations in light of the Bible and tell you why I'm not part of that denomination. Now, a lot of people might think, well, you're attacking. I don't want to attack. I just simply want to take the Bible and say, what does the Bible teach, and what does that denomination teach? And then I want to say, I'm a Bible believer, so I'm going to go with the Bible. So I'm just pointing out differences between the Bible and what groups or denominations or churches or hierarchy type religious organizations teach, and why I'm not one of those. You see, I'm a Bible believer, a King James Bible believer, and I choose to follow what the Word of God says. There's a lot of men out there that say other things. In fact, the Bible says, let God be true, but every man a liar. So today we're going to look at this teaching known as Calvinism, and I'm going to tell you why I'm not a Calvinist. I've met a lot of Calvinists, I've known a lot of Calvinists over the years, and actually some of them are the nicest people I've ever met. But they choose to follow a man rather than the Bible. So what is Calvinism? What is Calvin? John Calvin was born around 1509 to about 1564. He was a French reformer and apologist. He was trained as a humanist lawyer, and then he left the Roman Catholic Church in around 1530. In 1536, he went to Geneva, Switzerland, and he set himself up a little kingdom there. If you read about John Calvin, you'll read about some very awful things. He was more like a little dictator than anything else. He set up a system of government in which he tried to put people under the law. If you spit on the sidewalk, you'd get lashings for it. If you did something that they didn't agree with, well, they would beat you, or you could even be burned at the stake for a certain thing. And in fact, there was a man named Michael Servetus who John Calvin actually burned at the stake. When John Calvin said, hey, if you come here to debate me, I'll let you debate, and I promise you safe passage. Because to Calvin, this man Servetus was a heretic. And you know what John Calvin did? He went against his word. And when that Michael Servetus, a Spaniard, came to that Geneva, Switzerland, Calvin put him in jail and literally burned him alive at the stake. He killed him. He was a murderer. He killed over religious differences, religious doctrine. And you see, he came out of the Catholic Church, and that was one of the things about the Catholic Church, is the Spanish Inquisition, and they killed all these people. And yet John Calvin killed somebody. So why I'm not a Calvinist? Well, the first thing I want to say, for the first reason why I'm not a Calvinist, is because I don't follow a man outside of the Bible. I follow the Scriptures, the Bible itself. I don't follow a man who's not in the Bible. And John Calvin was a man who set up his own system of teaching from the Bible. Many think that Calvin was a scholar. He wrote a gigantic book. It's actually in two volumes. Most places where you try to buy it, it's that big. It'd have to be actually two books instead of one. And he wrote what's called the Institutes, Calvin's Institutes, where he went through and tried to explain Bible doctrine. And a lot of people think he's a great man. And because of that, they choose to follow the man, John Calvin. But what does the Bible say about following a man? Well, Psalm 118:8 says it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. I don't want to follow a man. I don't want to be a follower of a man. Psalm 62:9 says, surely men of low degree are vanity, and men of high degree are a lie. Old Calvin, he was a man of high degree. He had many degrees. He was smart in his own mind. Many refer to him as a great scholar. But the Bible says men of high degree are a lie. And the rest of the verse, Psalm 62:9 says, to be laid in the balance and are altogether lighter than vanity. So what we're going to do is let's see if this shows up. We're going to, you remember the old balance that they had in the old days, the old scale? And they had this old scale in the old days, and you would weigh things. When you weighed it, you would see how much does it weigh. Well, what we're going to do is we're going to take the teachings of John Calvin, and we're going to weigh them with the Bible. And we'll do like the Bible says. We'll lay it in the balance. It says, to be laid in the balance, they are altogether lighter than vanity. Which one weighs more? Which one has more weight? The Bible or a man? John Calvin. In Proverbs 25:19, the Bible tells us, confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble is like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. I don't want to follow a man. I want to follow my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And the only way to do that, according to the Bible, is to follow the Apostle Paul. Now, I told you earlier, the reason that I don't follow Calvin, and I'm not a Calvinist, is because I don't follow a man outside of the Bible. But in the Bible, there is a man that we're to follow. Of course, there's Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh. And after the church age started, along came Peter and the early apostles and began to preach. And they were preaching to Jews, but eventually the message changed from Jews to Gentiles. And we're told in the Bible that God chose a man named Paul. And Paul is the man that we're supposed to follow today because Paul wrote Romans through Philemon. Those books are books for Gentiles in the church age. And in Romans chapter 11 and verse 13, Paul says that he is the apostle to the Gentiles. And look what it says in Romans chapter 15. Romans 15, 16 through 17, Paul tells us that I should be the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God, that the offering up of the Gentiles might be acceptable, being sanctified by the Holy Ghost. I have thereof, whereof I may glory through Jesus Christ in those things which pertain to God. So God gave us Paul as an apostle. And if you're not a Jew, then you're a Gentile. And the way to be saved today is through our minister, Paul. And God gave to Paul the gospel. And the gospel is 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4. Paul says, God revealed unto me the gospel. So, who am I going to follow? Am I going to follow the Bible? Well, the Bible tells me to follow Jesus through the writings of Paul. So that's the only man that I follow is the one in the Bible, Paul, who gave us the gospel of salvation through Jesus Christ. So why would I follow a different man outside of the Bible? I just can't. I can't follow a man outside of the Bible. One more verse real quick. 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. And this is the Apostle Paul speaking. So I don't need to read a book by a man called the Institutes and follow him. I need to read the book by God, the Bible, and follow what it says. And the Bible teaches and tells me in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16, the Apostle Paul writing, he says, wherefore I beseech ye, be ye followers of me. So I'm a follower of the Apostle Paul and his gospel. Matter of fact, in Romans 2:16, Paul says that the whole world will be judged according to this gospel right here. So I'd rather not follow a man. There's a lot of men out there that have written a lot of books. There are a lot of people that choose to follow men rather than the Bible. But I'm just going to follow the Scriptures. And the way to follow Jesus Christ today is through the writings of Paul. Now that doesn't mean we don't read the rest of the Bible. I read all the Bible. But I understand, and I rightly divide. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, rightly dividing the word of truth. And the way to rightly divide the Bible is to realize what's for us today are Romans through Philemon. That's the doctrine of the church for today. So, why I'm not a Calvinist? The number one reason that I'm not a Calvinist is because I do not want to follow a man outside of God, outside of the Bible. God gave me the Lord Jesus Christ as my Savior. And God revealed some things unto the Apostle Paul. And so Paul is the man that I would follow because the Bible instructs me to. Because Paul said, be followers of me as I am of Christ. I mention this because I've met a lot of Calvinists. And a lot of them make fun of Paul and say, don't you dare follow the Apostle Paul. Well, it shows you they'd rather follow a man rather than the Scriptures and what the Bible teaches. So, first reason I'm not a Calvinist is because I can't follow a man outside of the Bible. The second reason I'm not a Calvinist is because I actually believe the Bible. And what I've done is I've gone through and studied Calvinism. Matter of fact, when I was in Bible school, we had to take a class called Calvinism. And the entire class was given to show us that Calvinism doesn't line up with the Bible. And there was a book by Lawrence Vance called The Other Side of Calvinism. It was about 600 pages, and I read every word of that book. And it was quote after quote after quote after quote after quote of Calvinists. And then it showed what they said, and then it gave Bible verse after Bible verse after Bible verse, and showed what the Bible says. And after studying Calvinism, you know what I found? Calvinism does not line up with the Bible. But yet there are people today that say, well, I'm a Calvinist and I'm a Bible believer. Well, what is Calvinism? Well, people today call Calvinism an acronym, T-U-L-I-P. And they say that Calvinism, easily described, as easy as possible, Calvinism is tulip. What is tulip? Well, it's the five main points of Calvinism, of what this man, Calvin, taught. These five main points sum up Calvinism to a T. So much so that all Calvinists believe, I'm a tulip Calvinist, they will say. Now, not all Calvinists believe all five. You'll find some people that say, well, I'm a four-point Calvinist. I believe four, not five. There are some that say, well, I'm a three-point or I'm a two-point Calvinist. I am a no-point Calvinist, a zero-point Calvinist. I reject Calvin entirely and follow my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I take Paul as my apostle in the gospel that he gave for salvation. I am a zero-point Calvinist. So I'm just going to show you what Calvinism believes, what these points stand for. And then let's look at the Bible and see, does the Bible teach Calvinism? Or is it a teaching outside? Even though they use the Bible and say that the Bible teaches it, they use verses, but they change verses to preach what they want to teach. So, total depravity is the first tenet of Calvinism. Unconditional election is the second point of Calvinism. Limited atonement is what they call their third point of what they believe of Calvinism. Irresistible grace is the fourth point. And the fifth point of Calvinism has been changed over the years. And what they preach today sounds great because they changed it. But let's go back to what Calvin actually taught. What did Calvin teach? Perseverance. I hope I spelled that right. Of the saints. Now, a lot of people who are Calvinists today, and many Calvinists are Baptists, which is interesting, but many Calvinists of today say that's not right. It's preservation. They say it's preservation of the saints, and they say that's eternal security. But that is not what Calvin taught. If you read through Calvin's writings, you see that he taught perseverance of the saints. In other words, Calvin taught you had to endure to the end to be saved. And that was, as we'll see, that almost sounds like a faith plus works setup, where you had to get believe, but then you had to do works to stay saved. That's not good. That's not good. Now, I'm not misrepresenting Calvinism. I've read most of Calvinist writings. I've searched it. I've sought it out. And as I read through Calvinistic works, I want to chuckle how sad it is that they can't see that all these teachings are against the Scriptures. They're the ideas of a man, a murderous man, a hard, stern, mean man, instead of the teachings of the Scriptures. So let's look at these. Let's look at all five of the points of Calvinism and see if they do line up with the Bible. So first of all is total depravity. Calvinists believe, according to what they teach, that man is so depraved that he has absolutely no ability whatsoever to do right. He will always do wrong. And they go so far as to say that they believe man has no free will. Now, if you know Calvinists, you've probably heard of Calvinists. Calvinists say, we don't believe in free will. They'll tell you straight up. When I was a pastor here in Garson Point in Milton, Florida, when I was in Bible school, I pastored for about 5 or 6 months a church just up the road from where I live. And one of the men that came to the church, he was such a blessing, he was getting old, and he was a Calvinist. And also, he had Alzheimer's. And while I would preach, in the middle of preaching, he would stand up in the middle of church and say, whatever will be, shall be. Think on that. And he'd sit back down. And I'm trying to preach, and I'm preaching, and out of nowhere, he just did 3, 4, 5 times a sermon. He'd stand up and says, well, I believe whatever will be, shall be. Think on that. And he'd do that. He'd go, And because he'd been indoctrinated in Calvinism his whole life, he thought, whatever will be, shall be, because there's no free will. So whatever happens is what God wants to happen, because we can't choose to do anything ourselves. That's the teaching of Calvinism, and that's ridiculous. So the first thing I did was look up the word free will in the Bible. Because Calvinists believe we don't have a free will. Well, do you know what? The word free will appears 17 times in 17 verses in the King James Bible. So how could anyone be a Calvinist? Because Calvin says we have no free will. You look at Calvin, no free will. Okay, look at the Bible. The Bible says 17 times free will. So which one do you choose? Well, I cannot choose this one because it doesn't jive with the Bible. 17 times the Bible uses the term free will. I'll just mention a couple of verses. Leviticus 22:18, Leviticus 22:21, Leviticus 22:23, Leviticus 23:38, Numbers 15:3. I mean, I can keep going. Numbers 29:39, Deuteronomy 12:6, Deuteronomy 12:17, Deuteronomy 16:10, Deuteronomy 23:23. On and on and on. 2 Chronicles 31:14, Ezra 1:4, Ezra 3:5, Ezra 7:13, Ezra 7. That should be enough. The word free will is in the Bible. So obviously men have free will. So why would anyone follow a person that says men have no free will? I cannot be a Calvinist because I believe in free will. Men have a free will. So many, many times the Bible mentions free will. 17 times that term, that word, is used in the Bible. So I don't understand how a person could be a Calvinist. You just look at the first teaching, the first point of Calvinism, and it's totally and completely refuted by the Bible. Men do have a free will. Well, the second point of Calvinism is called unconditional election. And Calvinism talks a lot about before the foundation of the world. And according to Calvin and Calvinists, before God made anything, God determined how everything was going to turn out. Well, that'd be pretty dumb, wouldn't it? To make something and know how it's going to end up. Well, as I read the Bible, I see the reason God created everything was so that they would love Him. As a matter of fact, we're told that in Revelation 4:11, the reason everything is made is for thy pleasure. And they're talking to God, and they say, for thy pleasure it was and is created. So God created everything to please Him. How can you please God if you don't have a free will to choose to serve Him? Did God just create robots? Or did He create a sentient being with the opportunity to love? If you don't have a free will, you can't love. So, unconditional election. What is unconditional election? Calvinists believe and teach that before the foundation of the world, God chose certain people to be saved. And that no matter what, they'll be saved whether they want to be or not. And there are some people that God chose before the foundation of the world to be lost, and whether they want to be saved or not, they're going to be damned. And there's nothing they can do about it. If they want to be saved, they can't be. If they want to be lost, they can't be. God made them saved or lost before they were even created. That doesn't sound like a very caring and loving God, does it? Well, if we have a free will, then we can choose to accept or reject God. So you see how that sounds weird? What is an election? Well, when you have an election, it actually means you have a choice. We have an election in this country. We go to the ballot box and we choose. I'm going to vote for this person or this person. So just the very word election, that's, God didn't elect. It's us. He leaves us through free will the choice to elect whether or not we choose Jesus or we reject Jesus. So what does the Bible say about this? Does the Bible say that? Well, I looked up the word whosoever will in the Bible. And it appears 13 times in 11 verses in the King James Bible. What is whosoever will? It means whosoever, by their own will, can do such and such. So once again, free will to decide if you will accept or reject something. Calvin taught you don't have the right to accept or reject. You're either saved or you're lost, and only God knows it. Huh? So why did Jesus die? Let's look at some verses. Go to Mark, if you have your Bible. I hope you do. Mark chapter 8 and verse 35. In verse 35, Jesus is speaking. And we'll look at verse 34, the end of verse 34. Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the Gospels, the same shall save it. So Jesus says, whosoever will. That's free will. That's the word will. Whosoever will. So there is a will in a person to decide to accept or reject the gospel, reject Jesus Christ. Very end of the Bible, Revelation 22, 17, again we see free will. Revelation 22, 17 says, "And the Spirit and the bride say, Come, and let him that heareth say, Come, and let him that is athirst come, and whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely." We have a free will. And God says, whosoever will, come to me. So does that sound like unconditional election? No, it sounds like conditional election. God laid the condition. Hey, the condition is you decide. You accept me as your Savior because I died for you, or you reject me. It's up to you. Many people, when they're children, remember John 3:16. That's probably one of the most widely memorized verses in churches. What is John 3:16? Well, if you memorize John 3:16, it's very hard to become a Calvinist. Because John 3:16 does not jive with Calvinism. Because there's a whole lot of whosoevers in this passage. Let's begin in John chapter 3, and I'll start at verse 15 through 18. And in John 3:15, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. Whosoever. That's you. You decide. Are you going to be the whosoever? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God not, sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Okay, so if Jesus came to save the world, why didn't he foreordain before the foundation of the world to save all of them? Why would he send some to hell? No, he gave a choice. It's to choose. For God sent not his Son in the world to condemn the world, but that through the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. So you believe, you're saved. You don't believe, you're lost. It's your choice. The decision is yours. That's the condition. Choose to believe or choose to reject. If you don't believe, then you reject. So salvation is through free will, but it's through trusting what Jesus of his own free will did for us. John 4:14 says, "But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto eternal life." Romans chapter 10. There's just verse after verse after verse. There's so many verses that talk about the whosoever. Whosoever will. But what does that mean? That means of your own will, whoever you are, you can come to Jesus for salvation. I don't see why someone would preach, hey, you can't be saved. You're one of the non-elect and you'll never get saved. No, until you take your last breath, you have a chance to be saved. There's still grace offered for you to be saved if you'll just believe. Romans chapter 10, look at verse 11. "For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed." And then verse 12, "For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher?" And then verse 16, "But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And whosoever hears and believes is saved." Free will, free will, free will. Whosoever. So, the second tenet of Calvinism has problems. They say that God chooses some to be elect before they're even born, before the foundation of the world, and they're going to get saved whether they want to or not. And God chose some to be damned, and they're going to stay damned. They couldn't get saved if they try. But yet the Bible says, no, whosoever will, they can come and be saved. Jesus died for everyone. And that brings us to our next point. Who did Jesus die for? Well, according to Calvinism, they believe in limited atonement. What is the atonement? I've got a good video up on thecloudchurch.org under past sermons on the blood atonement. The atonement is the shedding of blood. Jesus Christ shed his blood for our sins. And not for ours only, but for the whole world, we'll see in a minute. Which means that Jesus didn't just die for some, Jesus died for all. So Jesus shed this blood to make an atonement for sins. He paid for sins. But the Calvinists, they believe that Jesus died for some sins and not all. As a matter of fact, they go so far, and I think this is utterly blasphemous, this is horribly stupid. I just cannot believe how a man could invent something like this. But they believe that Jesus only died for a limited amount of people. So when Jesus died on the cross and he shed his blood, he was thinking, oh, I'm only doing this for a couple of people, but other people I'm not doing it for. Is that right? I don't believe so. I don't believe Jesus only died for some people. I believe that that blood atonement was for everyone, but not everyone receives it because they have a free will. There are some people that want to be lost, and they want to go to hell. They don't want to be saved. And they don't go to hell because it wasn't their fault. They go to hell because they choose to reject Jesus Christ. So did Jesus Christ die for everyone? What a horrible thing to say that that atonement wasn't all-powerful enough to save the entire world. It was. The whole world could be saved if they accepted it. But some will accept and some will reject. So is limited atonement biblical? Let's look at some verses. 1 Timothy 2, 3 through 6. Again, Calvinists say Jesus only died for certain few. And those few are the ones that he chose before the foundation of the world, the elect. That's what they call them. So they say Jesus' death on the cross was only for some and not for all. I believe Jesus Christ died for the whole world. As a matter of fact, we're going to see there's a lot of verses. For God so loved the world. We just read it, John 3:16, that he gave. It doesn't say, for God so loved the elect that he died for some of them. He says, God so loved the world. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 through 6. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Who's the God our Savior? Jesus Christ. Verse 4, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for the elect. Is that what your Bible says? Look at your Bible at verse 6. That's not what it says. Who gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. For who did Jesus Christ die for? He died for A-L-L. All. So this limited atonement is not true. This is an atonement made by Jesus Christ that is for everyone. Now, not everyone accepts it, but it was made for everyone, for all. Let's look at some more verses. Titus 2:11. I do not see how a man could read the Bible and come out being a Calvinist. I think that's the problem. He doesn't read the Bible. He reads Calvin instead of the Bible. Because if you read the Bible, you look at Calvin, you go, nah, he ain't right. That's not right. Because the Bible says Jesus died for all. And Calvinists say, no, he only died for a limited number of people. Okay, well, I'll choose the Bible. That's why I'm not a Calvinist, because I choose to follow the Bible. Titus 2 and verse 11, it says that the grace of God that it bringeth salvation hath appeared to a limited number of people. Is that what that? No, that's not what my Bible says. It says to all men, A-L-L. So the grace of God is offered to all for salvation. And because they have a free will, some accept it, others reject it. But that doesn't mean that Jesus died for all of them. Can you imagine going to hell knowing that Jesus did everything necessary to pay for your sins? All you had to do was believe, and you missed it. What a shame. What a shame. Well, let's go to some more verses. 1 Timothy 1:15. I'm just giving you Bible verses, and I'm just telling you why I am not personally a Calvinist. Now, if you are, help yourself. But you've got a really big problem, because what you're believing seems to not line up with the Scriptures. It's the teachings of a man, but it's not the teachings of the Bible. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15, it says, this is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Who did Jesus die for? Sinners. Okay, so has there ever existed in the time of man a time when a man wasn't a sinner? Well, the only person that wasn't a sinner was Jesus. So every other person ever since Adam till the end of time that's ever born is a sinner. And guess who Jesus died for? For every single one of them, not a limited number of people. It's that simple. I don't see how you could be a Calvinist. Second Corinthians chapter 5, and look at verse 14 and 15. 2 Corinthians 5, 14 and 15. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. So Jesus died for all. And that he died for all, that we should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him that died for them and rose again. Who did Jesus die for? For all men. Just as we've read earlier. Who is all? Let's go to 1 John chapter 2 and verse 12. I said 12, excuse me. 1 John 2, 2. 1 John chapter 2 and verse 2. Who did Jesus Christ die for? Did he just die for some? Or did he die for all sinners that ever lived and ever will live? It says, and he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. I've got a little note here. My Bible says, anti-Calvinist verse. Yeah, that's an anti-Calvinist verse, because Jesus Christ, when he died for the sins of the whole world. So why are you saying he only died for a limited number of people? I don't understand Calvinism. And I guess it's because I read the Bible rather than Calvin. I talk to people that are Calvinists and say, oh, you just don't understand. Yeah, because they're spending all their time reading two thick, huge volumes of books called the Institutes, rather than reading the book that God gave us called the Bible, the King James Bible. 1 John 4:10 is another good verse. 1 John 4:10 says, herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. You see, because of love, Jesus Christ died on the cross. And what did he love? He loved the world, for God so loved the world that he died for everyone. To say that Jesus only died for a certain number is to attack the love of God. And to say God must have hated some because he only died for some and hated others. No, because he loved the world, he died for the sins of everyone. All people. All men. So are you starting to see that Calvinism isn't what it's cracked up to be? I don't see how a person could choose to be a Calvinist. Maybe they just don't read the Bible. Maybe that's the whole problem. Don't be a Calvinist. Don't follow a man. Follow God. Follow the Scriptures. So we've looked at the first three. Let's look at the fourth one, irresistible grace. Irresistible grace. What did Calvinists teach about this? Well, they believe that you cannot resist salvation. If you are one of the elect, one that God chose before the foundation of the world to be saved, whether you want to or not, when God comes upon you, you cannot resist him, and you will get saved. That's what they teach. Is that what the Bible says? Well, a lot of them use Acts chapter 6 and verse 10. And in Acts 6:10, it says, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and spirit by which he spake. And they say, see, they were going to get saved. They couldn't resist the Spirit of God. That's a Calvinist verse that they use to try to prove that you can't resist. Well, for people that read a lot, Calvinists, they must not read the Bible a lot, because you don't even have to go one chapter to see something else. Look at Acts chapter 7 and verse 51. Stephen is preaching to these religious leaders. And look what Stephen says in Acts 7:51. He says, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, why do you always resist the Holy Ghost? As your fathers did, so do ye. Calvin says you can't resist it. Bible just said there's some people resisting the Holy Ghost. Who are you going to follow? I'm over here. You know, we started this whole verse, this whole thing out, by saying that we're to weigh in the balances. And men of high degree are a lie. And you know what we're finding out? We're finding out that Calvin didn't know what he was talking about. And we're finding out the Bible is true. And John Calvin is not. Maybe you can see this. This is my scale up here. The Bible holds more weight than Calvin. A lot more weight than Calvin. Because Calvin says, well, it's this way. And the Bible says, nope, it's the opposite. Who do you follow? Can we resist the grace of God? Yeah. Because that's what he said. Why do you always resist the Holy Ghost? As your fathers did. Not just them. But the Old Testament, they resisted the Holy Ghost. They resisted God coming and preaching to them. Go to Romans chapter 13 and verse 2. Romans 13, 2, talking about resisting the Holy Spirit, resisting the will of God. You see, if you don't have a free will, then you can't resist what God wants. But if you do have a free will, then you can resist. I've got children. How can you have children and not believe in free will? You tell your kids, do this, do this, do this. And you know, eventually they're going to stand up and go, no, I don't want to. What is that? That's God showing through your kids that we are depraved, but that we do have a free will. I don't see how you can be a Calvinist and have children. People want to do what people want to do. We don't all, like robots, obey God and do everything God said. Burp, burp, I'm a robot, I will obey. No, we have a sinful nature. And because of that, we rebel against what's right. And the free will is what makes us choose to do wrong. Well, you don't understand that if you're a Calvinist. Look at Romans 13:2. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Here we see someone resisting God. What does Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 29 say? Are you starting to see what we're doing here? Calvinists say these are the points that we unite on and we believe these. And so far, every one of them is the exact opposite of what the Bible says. They say, oh no, there's more to it. No, there's not. I'm trying to reduce everything down to the simplest terms, just like you do, Mr. Calvinist. And you reducing all those books of Calvin into five little points. Well, that's what we've done. We've taken your five little points and we've refuted them with the Bible. And guess what? They don't line up. They don't jive. They're not the same. They don't agree. So Calvinism is not for me. And that is why I'm not a Calvinist. So I told you to go to Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 29. Hebrews 10, 29. It says, "And how much sore punishment suppose ye shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God, and hath counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he hath sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace." My Bible has Spirit, capital W. That's the Holy Spirit. Someone has done despite to the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? That means they have gone against the Spirit of God. Well, that almost sounds like they resisted something. Well, guess what? It says the Spirit of grace. They say you cannot resist the grace of God, and someone has just done it in this verse. In Acts 7:51 again, Stephen says, "Why do you resist the Holy Ghost?" Well, Calvinists like to talk and try to make themselves look like they're so scholarly and smart. And one of the things Calvinists like to do is get around and talk and try to seem smart in the eyes of others by asking questions. And one of the main questions that Calvinists like to ask is they say, "Well, I have something for you to think about. What if an irresistible force comes down upon an immovable object? What would happen?" And they say, if the force is irresistible and the object is immovable, what can happen? And they talk about, and they talk like that. It sounds like they're crazy. Where in the Bible does it talk about an irresistible force and an unmovable object? That's something some man made up in his mind. God says you can resist some stuff. But they talk about, what if an irresistible force comes upon an unmovable object? What will happen? Well, my old pastor, one time they asked him that in Bible school. There were a lot of Calvinists in the school that he went to. And they were asking him that after he wrote his thesis and he wanted to graduate from that school. And those old puffed up, big fat gospel blimp Calvinists said, "Mr. So-and-so, what happens when an irresistible force falls upon an immovable object?" Old scholarly people thought they were so smart. And my old pastor just goes, "Well, that's easy. It breaks. If the force is irresistible and the object is unmovable, then it's going to bust into a million pieces." He said, "It shatters." That makes sense to me. But they don't understand. So if you're a Calvinist and you believe in irresistible grace, I got bad news for you. That's not what the Bible teaches. You can, because you have free will, choose to resist the Holy Ghost and choose to resist salvation. So you're not off to a good start, Mr. Calvinist. You're wrong on this one. You're wrong on this one. You're wrong on this one. And you're wrong on this one. How about the last one? Well, par for course, you're wrong on that one too. I've met people that say, "Well, I'm a one-point Calvinist, and this is the only one I believe." And the reason they say that is because Calvinists over the years have changed what Calvin really said to this over here. And when Calvin wrote it down, or when Calvin began to preach it, he preached preservation of the saints. Endure to the end. And what he was really preaching was, you have to do good works until you die to prove that you're saved. Well, that almost sounds like a faith plus works setup. And if you're trying to add any works to your salvation, I got news for you. You are not saved. That's not grace. Grace is a free gift. By accepting Jesus Christ, you receive eternal life. You don't get it by believing and then doing good works. So some people, like myself, think that Calvin might not even have been saved because he was trying to add to salvation works. But his system was not preservation of the saints, was not eternal security. Even though today we believe in eternal security because that's a Bible doctrine. When you're saved, you have eternal life and you cannot lose that because you're sealed by God. So what is perseverance of the saints and what does the Bible teach? Well, Calvinists say you know you're saved because you're doing right. So if you're doing right, then they say then you must have been one of the elect that God chose. And they use the verse Matthew 7:20, "Wherefore by your fruits you shall know them." And they go around and say things like, "Well, I'm just a fruit inspector, and I go around and inspect people and see if they're doing right, and if they are, then I can say, well, they're saved because they're doing right." Really? Who made you a fruit inspector? Who made you judge? Are we supposed to run around and judge people? I mean, that's what this system does. Makes people run around and stand in judgment of others and say, "I'm watching you. Yeah, I don't think you're safe because I don't like what you're doing." And it gets all the emphasis on man rather than on Jesus Christ. So it makes you wonder about old Calvin. And Calvinists say, if a man sins, then that proves he wasn't one of the elect to begin with and he was never saved. And so if you're a Calvinist, you can't ever say, "Well, I know when I got saved." You have to think, "Well, I'm saved. How can I know I'm saved?" It's because I'm doing good. And you know what that leads to? If a person doesn't understand the gospel, that leads to a person thinking, "I'm saved by what I do, my works, rather than saved by what Jesus did for me." So Calvinism is such a convoluted, messed up system that it can leave a person lost and not knowing if they're saved or not. I'm going to get to that in a second. But did you know that a Calvinist can never know if they're saved? No Calvinist can ever look you in the face and say, "I know beyond a shadow of a doubt 100% that I'm saved." They can't know that. I'm going to get to that in a second. Let me go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Because in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 5, there's a guy that's living in fornication, and he's a member of the church, and he's saved. And Paul writes about him. Now, I'm not saying that you should live in fornication. Oh, no. Paul said, flee fornication. But here's a guy that is saved that's living in fornication. Is he saved? Is he one of the elect? Yes. And we'll see that. In chapter 5, verse 1, "It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you, and such fornication is not so much as named among the Gentiles that one should have his father's wife." He says, "You are puffed up and have not mourned, that you might have done this deed might be taken away from you." He says in verse 3 that, "For verily as absent in body, but present in spirit, have judged already, as though I were present concerning him that had done so this deed, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together, that in my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ," verse 5, "to deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh." All right, a lot of people stop right there and don't read anymore. Well, when you sin, you pay for it in your flesh. But if you're saved, your soul is saved. Your soul can't go to hell. So offer up the flesh to Satan. Let Satan have him to do like Satan did to Job. Give him something in his flesh to pay for it. But look what the rest of the verse says. "That the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus Christ." So if you're saved, no matter what you do, and I'm not saying you should go do that, that's not an excuse to sin. I serve God and live right because I'm saved, not to get saved or stay saved. But do you see what this teaches? You can't ever know if you're saved, but you have to live right in order to prove you're saved. So the works is what you look at in the hope that you get to heaven. What does that sound like? It sounds like works for salvation. Works for salvation. If you're saved and you sin, you're still saved. You don't do good works and then say, "Well, I hope I'm saved because I'm doing those." That's damnation because you're trusting in yourself and your works rather than Jesus Christ. And there are a lot of Calvinists I don't think are even saved. And yet they're doing good works to try to say, "Look how great I am. That means I hope I'm one of those elect. I must be because look how great I am." And all the emphasis and focus and glory is on you instead of Jesus. Let's look at some more verses. Let's go to Romans chapter 7. According to the Calvinist argument, you can only know if a person's saved based upon how they're living. And if they're living a good life, then they're saved. If they're not, they're lost. That's point. That's the way they view it. That's the way they say, if you're living right, you're saved. If you're not, you're lost. But even lost people can be moral and live good lives. How can you dogmatically say that? What makes you saved? Whether or not you've accepted Jesus Christ. But they don't tell you that. They bypass that. They'll talk about it, but then they'll say, but it was only limited. And they'll say, yeah, you got to be one of the elect for that to mean anything. It's like they do spite to the Spirit of grace, and they trod underfoot the blood of Christ, and they don't magnify Jesus and say salvation's through what he did. It's like they're saying it's all what you do. And what you do determines whether you are the elect or not. That's not right. Romans chapter 7, verse 15. Let's pretend to be Calvinists for a second. And let's look at the Apostle Paul and see if he was one of the elect, based upon what he says. Let's see, we're Calvinists, and we're saying, Paul, you saved, tell me about your testimony, Paul. Well, Romans 7, 15, Paul says, for that which I would do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more that I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will, Paul just said, I've got a free will. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that do I. So Paul says, I try to do right all the time, and I have a will in me wanting to do right, and yet I do wrong. And I find that I want to do wrong, but I have to put the flesh down and fight it in order to do right. Now, if you're a Calvinist, Paul sounds like he's lost and going to hell, doesn't he? Because he's confessing that he does wrong all the time. Let's look at verse 24. Paul says, oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Paul says, I am nothing, I'm nobody. Look how horrible I am, I'm just an awful sinner. Matter of fact, in the other verse we read, Paul said, of sinners, I'm the chiefest of sinners. He said, I'm the absolute worst. Well, if we're Calvinists, and we listen to that testimony of Paul, then we must say that Paul wasn't saved. He wasn't the elect. So we'll just have to ignore Paul and forget about Paul altogether. Because only in Calvinism can we believe we're one of the elect by the fact that we're doing right and not sinning. And if we ever sin, then that proves, oh, I wasn't one of the elect. Do you see how dumb a system of theology that is? It makes you think, I think I'm one of the saved ones. I think I am because I'm doing right. Well, what do you do when you do wrong? Oh, I was never saved to begin with. I've seen people get into Calvinism and learn all this and then just not do right. And they fall into sin and they say, well, might as well give up. I'm not one of the elect and I never can be, so I might as well enjoy my sin because I'm going to hell. Isn't that horrible? Why did someone come to them and say, no, you don't have to go to hell. Jesus died for all your sins. And you can be saved. Just come to him and trust the gospel. And if you sin or not, that doesn't matter. What matters is whether or not you've trusted him as your Savior. Yeah, when he saves you, you'll try to live sinless. Yeah, when you're saved, you'll try to do right. But even Paul said, it's the sin in my flesh. And even though I walk in the Spirit, I still have the flesh. And the things that I would not, those I do. Well, Calvinists don't know if they are saved or not. Let me start this to the beginning. Why I'm not a Calvinist. Number one, the reason I'm not a Calvinist is because I don't follow men outside of the Bible. Number two, I'm not a Calvinist because I believe the Bible and I've looked at each one of these points and they don't line up with the Scripture. And the third reason, this is the final point, the last reason that I'm not a Calvinist is because I know I'm saved. How do you know? You see, Calvinism teaches that you can never know if you're saved or not. Because of this last point. You can never, ever know if you're saved because you have to persevere. You have to endure to the end to know whether or not you're saved or not. Does the Bible teach that? Well, no, it does not. As a matter of fact, no, the Bible does not teach that. The Bible teaches us that we can know that we're saved. You know, I've met Calvinists before, and I like to ask a Calvinist, hey, when did you get saved? And I've never yet, to this day, met a Calvinist that told me when he got saved. Because Calvinism, if you accept that line of teaching, you can never know. All you can do is just hope you're one of the elect. And hope when you die, you go to heaven. Because you hope that God chose you before the foundation of the world, but you can never know. But according to the Bible, you can know. So Calvinism teaches you can never know. And all you can do is hope. You can never know you're saved. You can just hope you're saved. But according to the Bible, you can know beyond any shadow of a doubt that you're saved and on your way to heaven. How do you know? Because you know by your own free will, you've chosen Jesus and accepted him by faith as your Savior. Do you see how in Calvinism you can't know that? So, 1 John 5:13, I love this verse. 1 John 5:13, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. So the Bible teaches beyond any shadow of a doubt that you can know that you have eternal life, and know you're going to heaven when you die. But according to Calvinism, you can never know that. All you can do is endure to the end and hope you did good enough, and hope you were one of the elect. And what if you weren't? What if you bought into this system and you weren't one of the elect, and you lived a holy life your whole life and you died and still went to hell? Wouldn't that be horrible? What an awful God that would be, that made you do right your whole life, and you never got to have any fun, never got to do anything good and enjoy life. You just were a prude your whole life, walking around, oh, I hope I'm the elect, I hope I'm the elect, oh, I'm doing right, I'm giving alms to the poor, I don't do bad things, I don't, and then you die, you're burning in hell. You know, you should have thrown Calvin out the window and come to the Bible. Because Calvinism gives no assurance of salvation. None. You can't ever know you're saved under Calvinism. You can just hope. That's why I read earlier that verse, Psalm 33:22. Let my mercy, O Lord, be upon us according as we hope in thee. All the Calvinists can do is just hope.
Well, I just hope I'm one of the elect, and I just hope I go to heaven when I die. I hope so.
I told you earlier, I've talked to many of them. Hey man, I'm a Calvinist. Oh, you're a Calvinist? Well, do you know you're saved? And this is how they say, well, I hope so. You hope so? Uh-uh, that's not good enough for me. Do you know you're saved? Well, I hope I'm one of the elect. No, are you saved? Do you know it? Well, I hope so. Do you see how that's not salvation? That's, I just hope I am, but you never know if you are saved. Look at some more verses. 2 Timothy 1:12. We're almost done here, but I hope this has been an encouragement to you. I cannot be a Calvinist. I just can't. I can't be a Calvinist. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 12. For the which cause I also suffer these things, nevertheless I am not ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. I know, the Apostle Paul says. In the Bible, being saved is like two things. When you're saved, you're born again. So being saved is like being born. And the Bible talks about the bride of Christ. And someday the bride of Christ will be married to Christ. But we're espoused to Christ. As far as God's concerned, we're already married in His eyes. So being saved is like two things, being born and being married. Now, who has ever been married? And then you go, hey man, are you married? And they say, well, I hope so. I mean, who's that lady next to you? Oh, that's my wife. What do you mean you hope so? Didn't you go down and get a certificate? Didn't you get married in a church? Oh, yeah, we did that. So, are you married? Well, I hope I am. What do you mean you either know you're married or you don't? Same with salvation. You either know you're saved or you don't. And to hope so isn't good enough. If you just hope so, then you're probably not. Being born. Who comes up to you and go, hey man, are you born? Well, I hope I'm born. You don't say, I hope. You know you're born because you're actually there. I mean, it's ridiculous to say, well, you can never know you're saved, and yet that's what Calvinism teaches. You can never know you're saved. All you can do is just hope so. Well, I hope I'm born. Well, I hope I'm born again. No, you know you're born the first time, and if you're saved, then you know you're born again. You know you're saved. Salvation is a no-so salvation. It's not a hope-so, hope-so. It's a no-so salvation. When you're saved, you know it. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 3. I'll just show you a couple more verses. I don't want to go too long. But at the same time, I want this to kind of be as definitive as possible. Why I'm not a Calvinist. And all I've done is show you what the Bible says and what Calvin said. And why I choose the Bible rather than a man who murdered another man and who wrote a gigantic book of doctrine in which he twisted the scriptures to leave you in a state where you can never know you're saved. That sounds horrible. Thank God the Bible tells you you can be saved and know it. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Know ye not that ye are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? Again, in 6:19 it says almost the same thing. Paul says, don't you know this? in verse 19 of chapter 6, 1 Corinthians, what? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own? When you're saved, you know you're saved. And you know what else you know, according to the Bible? That the Spirit of God dwells inside you. So if the Spirit of God dwells inside you, how do you go to hell? If you know the Holy Spirit's in you, then you know you're going to heaven, because the Holy Spirit can't go to hell. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, the Bible tells us what happens when a man believes. In Ephesians 1:13, it tells us that the very moment you believe, you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. In whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. I know that I'm saved. I got saved July 29th, 1992, about 10 o'clock in the morning. I heard the gospel for the first time in my life. I understood what Jesus did for me. And I chose, of my own free will, I believed in Jesus Christ as my Savior. And then I knew that I was saved because I believed the word of God. And guess what? I didn't believe the word of Calvin. I believed the word of God. The problem with Calvinists is they believe the words of Calvin rather than believing the words of God. A couple more verses. Ephesians 1, 18, since we're right there. The eyes of your understanding be enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory is of his inheritance in the saints. The Bible talks about there's things you need to know. You need to know you're saved. Well, you can't know you're saved and be a Calvinist, because Calvinists set up a system of theology in which you can never know if you're one of the elect. All you can do is just walk around going, I hope so, I hope so, I hope so, I hope so, oh God, I hope so, I hope God chose me before the foundation of the world, I hope so, I hope so, I hope so. Bunk. Phooey on that. I know that I'm saved and on my way to heaven. If you're saved, you know it. I've never met a Calvinist yet who knew he was saved. They've always said, well, I hope so. Well, I hope so. I hope I'm one of those elect. Well, you're probably not. So why don't you get saved? And maybe you are. I met some Calvinists. I think they are saved. But they allowed their mind to be messed up by this man. And to think about things that happened before God even created us. I don't think about things that happened before the foundation of the world, because that doesn't pertain to me. I think about the world, the things that are happening, things that happened during the world. And I think about what Jesus did for me. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. I like what Peter says. For as much as ye know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by the tradition of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a lamb without blemish and spot. Peter says, for as much as ye know that you're redeemed with the precious blood of Jesus. That's what those two verses say. You can know that you're redeemed. What does redeemed mean? It means to be purchased. It means to be bought back. When you're saved, you are purchased by Jesus Christ, and you know whether you're saved or not. Like I said, I never, ever met a Calvinist that said, I know I'm saved. They always said, well, I hope I'm one of the elect. Well, guess what? Get out of Calvin and get in the Bible, and then you'll know that you're saved. I'm going to close with this. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Verses 1 through 4. I've met some Calvinists. I wish I could give you stories about them. While I'm going to 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, I'll tell you a story real quick. I went to a church one time out west. I don't remember. Was it California or Nevada or someplace out that way? And went into that church. Didn't know what it was or anything about it. Sat down with the pastor and ate some lunch. And, man, we talked for a good hour. I mean, it was awesome. We had great fellowship. And then all of a sudden, that pastor just stopped and he goes, now, brother, I want to tell you something. I'm a Calvinist. And I went, you're funny, brother. He goes, no, I'm serious. I'm a Calvinist. I said, really? He said, yep. He said, when you preach tonight at this service, he said, you'll preach your message and then you'll sit down and you'll shut up. We do not give invitations. We do not believe that man can make a decision on his own. So you preach a message and then you sit down and then we'll close the service. And I'll tell you what, that was probably the worst service I've ever been in my entire life. I preached a hard, good message, not one amen. It was like you could hear the crickets. It was so quiet. I felt like I was at a funeral in a funeral home. And I got done and I wanted to say, now what are you going to do about it? And all I could do was just look at the pastor and say, well, I guess I'm finished. And he said, okay, let's pray to leave. And it's like God wanted to move on the hearts of those people, but because of that system, nobody could make a decision. So it was like, am I wasting their time or are they wasting mine? Calvinism, it's crazy. 1 Corinthians 15, 1-4, the Bible says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, which also you received, and wherein you stand." If you stand in the gospel, guess what you are? Verse 2, you are saved. If you're in the gospel and you believe the gospel, then guess what? You're saved and you know it. I've read a lot of tracts by Calvinists, and a lot of them mention the gospel. And so I think a person can get saved. But a lot of them get saved, but then get under this system, and they always wonder if they're saved or not. What is the gospel? The gospel is that Christ died. Who did he die for? He died for us, for our sins. So who did he die for? He died for all. He died for everybody. He was buried. He rose again. And then the Bible says, according to the Scriptures. That's the gospel. I didn't read it. I'll go ahead and read it. Verse 2, "By which also you're saved, and you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain." What does it mean to believe in vain? It means to believe in something other than the gospel. What is this Calvin thing? It's vanity. It's vain. Matter of fact, one of the first verses I read, let's go back to it. "Surely men of low degree are vanity, and men of high degree are a lie." Psalm 62:9. "To be laid in the balance, they're altogether lighter than vanity." Well, the gospel says you're saved by the gospel. Unless you believed in vain. Are you believing in Calvin rather than believing in the gospel? You're believing in vain. And it says, verse 3, "For I delivered to you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." If you want to be saved and know that you're on your way to heaven, without any shadow of a doubt, you know you're saved. It's through trusting the gospel. Trust what Jesus Christ did for you. Believe that he did it. It doesn't matter who's elect or who's not. All that matters is you. Are you saved? Do you know that you're going to heaven? Calvin didn't. All he could do was set up a system of theology in which he hoped he was one of the elect. And many people that follow Calvin to this day, they don't even know if they're saved or not. All they can do is just hope so. "Oh, I just hope I'm one of the elect." I don't want to live like that. I thank God that I put Calvin in his place. Where's his place? Lower than vanity. And exalt the Bible. The Bible's weight. It's weighty. And guess what? I thank God that the Bible tells me I can know that I'm saved. So I appreciate you coming and watching this video. I hope it's been a blessing to you. I'm trying not to attack or put down anyone. I've just objectively told you why I'm not a Calvinist. And the reason I'm not a Calvinist is because this is Calvinism. And this is the Bible. And it appears to me, after studying Calvinism, that it doesn't fall in line with the Scriptures. That it's against what the Bible teaches. So I choose to follow God and His Word rather than Calvin. So thank you for watching. I pray this has been a blessing. If you got saved through this video, please write to us. We'd love to hear it. Maybe this opened your eyes and you decided to get out of Calvinism. Good. Get into a good Bible-believing church that preaches the gospel and preaches salvation by faith. We need to tell people the gospel. That's what it's all about, is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not telling people, "Well, do you know what this man said?" No, how about pointing people to Jesus Christ and what he did? So thanks for watching. Come back to Cloud Church every week for a new sermon in English and Spanish. We're always posting Bible study videos, and we're starting this new series of Why I Am Not. I think one of our next ones will be Why I'm Not a Pentecostal. I think will be our next one. So come back and check it out. We appreciate you watching. God bless.